Yo, what is up? This is part two of the RISC-V in RARS series. We'll be looking at three instructions, add, add I, and sub. The sample code that I will be going over also has a pseudo instruction, which is J, standing for jump. That just jumps to a specific location. We won't really worry about it, but it is in there, so just be aware of that. All right, let's get started. Shouldn't take more than 5 to 10 minutes. All right, so we are using the Linux operating system. Everything should be the same as it would be if we were on Windows or OS X. Let's go ahead and open up RARS. If you're on Windows, you may just be able to click the .jar file, but for all systems, this will work. We CD'd into the directory, then we should run java-jar, and there we go. You could put the whole file path in there. I couldn't find it, so I CD'd into the directory and then ran the java-jar, but whatever works for you is what works for you. Hit enter. Boom, it opens right up. All right, so as I said before, there are three instructions we will be worried about today, and this pseudo instruction, which is something we're not really worried about because all it's going to do is jump us back to the location specified here, which is the main. This is an infinite loop, and the source code can be found in my GitHub, the RARS GitHub, in the infinite loop. It's just called infinite loop. You can find it in the GitHub. All right, so before we start looking at these instructions, let's just give ourselves a quick overview of what's going on in the RARS to understand what things are doing once we start running things. So here in this pane, we have the edit and execute. The edit tab is going to show you the .asm file or whatever file really, and that's just where you do the typing. This is where you do your coding. The execute tab is going to show you what values mean. So we have the instruction line here, add I, and I've already run an instruction, that's why the highlighting is on the second line, but we have the add I x6 x0 10. That is the line that we have in code. And then we have the source. This is going to tell you what line number it is. These two are basically the same. And then we have the code. This is going to tell you the hexadecimal version of the instruction. And then we have the address. And this is going to tell you where things are. All right. Then we can go to the registers tab and we'll see here the name section. The name section is actually going to tell you the registers. There's the register actual and then the register name. So you can look at the RISC-V card-large.pdf, and this will, and I'll probably rename this, so it'll still be in the reference folder. But if you scroll down to the second page, there'll be the register name, use, and calling convention, and this will give you the mapping of the actual register, which is what you'll use in the code, and then the register name, which is what you'll see in the registers tab. So T1 corresponds to two temporary. The three temporaries, X5, X6, and X7. So T1 is X6, which is what we have been affecting in the first line, and that is why the green highlight value has changed or is on T1. And you can use this to see what the other registers are corresponding to the names that are given in the registers tab. That's basically all you need to know for this section. So let's actually take a look at what these instructions mean. All right, so before we start assembling and running the code, let's take a look at the instructions and give ourselves a quick overview of what's going on. We have the add I instruction. That means add immediate. So in all of the instructions, the first value here, if you want to call it that, is where the result will be stored. So the add I function will end up in the X6 register. This is an add immediate. So we're going to take the first value and add it to the second value, which is going to be an immediate value, not stored in a register, just the actual number. Now, you might want to do that if all your registers are full, or maybe you have a value that's constant. There's a bunch of reasons why you'd want to do that, but it is a feature that is given to you. Add I. Next, let's take a look at the add instruction. And this page I'm looking at is a documentation page that I will post in the description, so you can follow along or look at it afterwards or have it for reference whenever you need it, which is what I will be doing. The add instruction and the sub instruction and the add I instruction all follow the same format, where the first value, which is a register. The first register is where the result will be. The second value is the first register, and the third value is the second register or an immediate value. So for the add I, we had one register and an immediate value all getting saved into the initial register. For the add instruction, we have the first register and the second register getting added together and stored in the initial register here. The add instruction is the same as the add I instruction, except it adds the registers RS1 and RS2. There is no room or option for an immediate. And finally, the sub instruction is going to sub the register S2, so the third item here, from the register 1, which is the second item here, or the first item here, if you want to call this the zeroth item, whatever you want to call it. Very simple. I do believe that it is actually just adding the additive inverse, is that what that is? Adding the additive inverse, I believe, of this value here. That is basically it. You got add I, which is going to take this plus this, add, which is going to take this plus this, and sub, which is going to take this minus this. So let's run the code and step through it. All right, so let's run this file. First thing you got to do is, when you open up a file and you have not run it before, or you only have the a.asm file, you want to obviously make sure that it's saved up. Then you need to assemble it. So you can click this screwdriver and wrench icon, or you can go to run and click the assemble option, or you can hit F3. Let's hit F3 because I haven't done that before. All right, so now it's assembled, and you know it's assembled because you'll see the two options for running. You can either run the program all at once. This is an infinite loop, so pressing this will pretty much do nothing because it won't stop. Or you can run one step at a time, and that'll allow you to see the register values being updated. So stepping through it, we should only see changes in the registers section. So let's do that. Okay, so we have run the first instruction. Now we can see that the highlighting has moved to the fifth line, or the second line in the execute section. So that is the line that will be run next. And we can see that in the registers tab, there is a green highlighting on the T1 named register. That is the value that was changed just now. So not the value that will be changed next, but the value that just got changed after hitting the run button. So this is the X6 value that should be changed here. And let's double check that that's right. So reviewing this line again, if you don't know what these registers are or what their name corresponds to, check the reference section in my GitHub and open up that RISC-V card PDF and go to the register name use and calling convention section 4, which is on the second page, and you'll see the register, the actual register in the name section here, as I mentioned before. And we can look at X0, seeing that that's the constant value 0. We can look at X6 and see that that is the T1 temporary. So we are adding 0 to 10 and saving it in the T1 register. And we can see here, you might not be able to see it. I have no way to zoom this in, unfortunately, but this is in fact the T1 named register. And the value here, it is hexadecimal, but the value here is A. And A in hexadecimal, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, A is 10. Hexadecimal 0 to 15, where 10 is A, 11 is B, 12 is C, 13 is E, 14 is F, 15 is G. Boom. So we got it. This is showing us what it should. So let's keep going. We can run the next line here, and we can see that this is X7, which, if we check the sheet, is the T2 temporary register. We have the X0, which is the constant value 0, and we have 64, which is the immediate value, or the actual value 64. So we are adding 64 to 0 and saving it in this register. And if you look here, we got T2, which is the X7 register, as we said before, and 40, and 40 in hexadecimal is 4 tens, or 4 16s and 0 1. So 4 times 16 happens to be 64. I didn't check it, but trust me, it is. Pushing on. Now we have the first different instruction. This is just add, which is adding two registers and storing them in the destination register. We have X28, which, if we look at the register name calling convention thingamajigger, we can see that X28 is another temporary and should correspond to T3. So if we run this, we should expect to see the T3 value, which is down here, change to 40A, because that is what 10 plus 64 equals. Let's check. Boom. T3, 4A. I might have said 40A. I meant to say 4A. And as you can see there, it's been changed to the correct value. It's in the 28th numbered register, which is named T3. And that is that. All right. And now we are at add 7. And this is the first line that exemplifies some additional possible use cases of these functions. Here we're adding x28 to x28 and storing it in x28, kind of like multiplying x28 by 2. And x28, again, is the T3 temporary. So we should expect that the T3 temporary will be updated to 4A plus 4A, which after checking on the calculator is 94 in hex or 148 in decimal. So we should expect the T3 value to change to 94. Let's click this button here and boom, there you go. It is 94. It is in the 28 numbered register, the name T3. Wowza. All right, the next instruction is another add function. Not too interesting. We are just again updating the T3 value by adding the T2 value, which was 64. So we are going to add 94 to 40, but we're gonna put that in the calculator right here because mental math has skipped that section in school. I wasn't there. D4. There we go. So that's why you don't do that in your head. So we should just expect the value D4. Not too interesting. And we see that T3 does in fact equal D4. And now we are at 9th line, the second to last instruction that is not a loop. The J is just going to send us back to the main and makes this a loop. This is kind of interesting. It's an add instruction, but the X7 value is going to be added to the immediate -2 value. It's an add I instruction. So this is kind of like a subtraction. Perhaps this is what the subtraction instruction is doing. Not really sure, but this is an interesting way to do that. And we should expect that the X7 value is decremented twice to 62, which is some number. I couldn't tell you what that is, but let's see what it is. Oh, 3E, and 3E should be 62. And we will find that it is. All right, so that's pretty cool. We can see here in this code that you can update values by adding to 0. You can do multiplication by adding a value to itself and storing in the same value, and you can do subtraction by adding a value to a negative value. So let's take a look at the subtraction instruction. All right, so here we are at the subtraction instruction. This is the final instruction in the loop, and this subtraction instruction is going to take the T1 value, subtract it from the T2 value, and store it back into the T2 value. Remember, the T2 named register is the X7 register, and the T1 named register is the X6 register. That's basically it. We can go ahead and run it, and we already did, actually, and we can see that we got the value 34. I ran it earlier, but to unrun something, great opportunity to showcase that, you can hit the undo button, and now you'll see the 34 value changed to 3E, and we can run it again, and we should expect to see 3E minus A, which does in fact give us 34. So that is that. What is this code doing? I think we should be able to tell by looking at just the raw code here without even really understanding much that there are three values, three variables, or three registers that are saved, updated, and used. The first register named T1 doesn't change. The second declared register named X7 or named T2 does get changed, and it gets updated twice here at the end. And the third named register, which is T3, also gets updated twice. T2 value is decremented by 2 and then decremented by 10, and the T3 register or value or whatever you want to call it is doubled and then added. Well, first it's set to be equal to the T1 and T2 register. It is then doubled, and then it is increased or incremented by the T2 register again. This doesn't end because there's no instruction that specifies any reason for it to end. There's nothing to cause this to end, so it will just run forever. And there's no output, so if I do hit run and let it run, you'll see nothing happening. And that is that. This was part 2. I hope you got a good understanding of those three instructions: add I, add, and sub. I will post the GitHub with the code in the description. I will also post the link to this hex calculator, and I'll also post the link to the documentation that I was looking at as I was giving explanations. Hope you have a fantastic Sunday or whatever day it is in the future. Enjoy life. I hope it is good to you, and I will see you part 3 in the future. Peace.